So this talk will be a little bit different than what I usually talk about. I'm usually talking about data and experiments and so on, and this is much more speculative, thinking about the consequences of doing the research that we're doing, projecting into the future, and we get much, much better at understanding what's going on. What are the consequences of that? I don't usually have the luxury of thinking about such things because we're deep inside designing and conducting experiments, but I thought it would be an interesting exercise. And I'm working on a new book in which I'm going to also explore these kinds of topics. So if we put up the slides. I labeled this the promise and peril of psychic technologies. And psychic here, you can think of both as consciousness related or and as psyche, meaning not just mind, but like the whole realm of mental space. I mentioned yesterday at the benefit lunch that at the end of May, I was invited to go to this Australian Leadership Retreat conference on Hayman Island, which is a tiny little island in the Great Barrier Reef. It's sponsored by the ADC Forum. ADC stands for Australian Davos Connection, which is related to the World Economic Forum, which meets in Davos, Switzerland. This is an opportunity for the world version for world leaders to get together, and these are presidents and captains of industry and so on, to think about strategic issues coming up in the world. And this is the Australian version of it. So this meeting was 130 people who run Australia, the people who are involved in government and business and military and education, who are the leaders. And as examples, heads of the military, their version of the National Science Foundation was there, a number of chancellors of universities, and a number of government ministers. And at one point I was surprised, well, why are we meeting on this tiny little luxury island in the middle of nowhere? And the answer was that because of the nature of the people there, especially the government people, that if we had met in a city somewhere, there would have had to have been security everywhere. Whereas this was almost impossible to find, so they didn't need lots of security around because no one knew we were there. The theme was thinking the unthinkable, and this is going on in every country in the world. The unthinkable thoughts that strategic leaders are thinking about are things like Alzheimer's. In the developed world, the average age is increasing pretty fast, and we don't know how to treat Alzheimer's very well, and it's getting worse. And that means we're looking in the future for a huge amount of additional medical expense. Uncontrolled population growth in non-developed countries on an exponential rise, that's also a problem because of resources. Climate change, something like 95% of the world's population lives next to the ocean. That's a problem. Terrorism, it's this notion of asymmetric warfare. A single person now can do a great damage to the rest of the world. We were very lucky that Ebola had not mutated into an airborne virus or airborne transmission. If it had, we probably would not be sitting here today. Not because we'd be dead, but because things like air travel would have been very severely blocked. Mass extinction refers to mass extinction of species, which is going on at an accelerated rate, faster than certainly in recent history. Resource depletion everywhere in the world, runaway artificial intelligence among those who think that technology is going to save us from all of this. And the major problem in all, each one of these is an apocalyptic scenario, but it's the combination of them that are scaring the leaders because their word is threat multiplication. They actually don't know what would happen if two or more of these interact in ways that we don't know how to handle. And so this was the discussion for about a day, and at the end of the day, you just wanted to go to sleep and cry. Because when you saw that the leaders of a large country were basically running scared, you know, they're talking about, this is what keeps me up at night, that's not very nice. Well, I knew that this was going to be the topic of conversation, and so the heads of this conference said that they needed a couple of people to talk about more positive things. And could I talk about the future of human potential? And so I gave it in these terms. What if your mind is more than your brain? And what if your mind is not limited by space and time? If that were true, then there's a possibility that we may be able to think our way out of some of these unthinkable thoughts, simply by taking advantage of our own capacities that we're not using fully. So I opened my talk by referring to Sir William Thompson, who gave a talk to the Royal Society in 1900, and he said that the beauty and clearness of physics is at present obscured by two clouds. And he meant that in a very minor way, basically physics is wrapped up, this is 1900, except for two little things on the horizon that will probably clear up soon and then we'll be done. And at the time, physics was considered to be so complete that students were no longer being encouraged to go into physics for that very reason. Well, the two clouds were called the luminous ether and ultraviolet catastrophe. The luminous ether turned into relativity, and the ultraviolet catastrophe, when it was understood, turned into quantum mechanics. Those two clouds transformed the 20th century. It brought us from the industrial age to the atomic age and then the information age. And so from, I mean, you could imagine someone asking Sir William Thompson, what do you suppose will be the outcome of understanding these two little clouds? He would have no idea. He couldn't even guess. Well, I think we're headed towards another even more radical transformation today, because we have two clouds on the horizon. One is called qualia, which is referring to the sense of internal awareness. Where does that come from? Is it the 3 pounds of tissue in your head that are somehow making this feeling of internal self? The other one is quanta. It's nice that they both begin with Q, Q-U, Q-U-A. Quanta refers to one of the puzzles in quantum mechanics that quantum systems change their behavior when they're observed. And this makes it extremely different than classical physics. Because in classical physics, it's assumed that things are out there, and if you observe them, they don't change. Quantum physics is very different. So what's curious about both of these are two outstanding problems. They're both having to do with the nature of mind and matter and their interaction. So if we look now at what we think we know about mind-matter interaction, it's a little bit like the surface of the sea or the tip of an iceberg, and we don't know very much yet. There's a little bit that we know that we don't know. So this is just below the surface. These are the questions that are researched now. We're trying to probe deeper into this. And then there's, of course, this.
There are known knowns. There are things we know we know. We also know there are known unknowns. That is to say, we know there are some things we do not know. But there are also unknown unknowns. The ones we don't know, we don't know.
So regardless of what you may think about Rumsfeld, that was a good thing that he said, because it is true that in the realm that we're working, there are lots of unknowns that we don't even know what the questions are yet. This is when we go down deeper than we know today. So we need to keep that in mind. And among other things, it should and does for me keep us very humble about what we think we're studying. Because when we don't even know what questions to ask yet, then it becomes interesting. So what do I mean then by psychic technologies? These are methods for significantly expanding consciousness. In some cases, it means much better psychic experience, talking about things like telepathy and so on, but probably even beyond that, because what we think of as psychic phenomena are usually classified in just a couple of little forms, and there are probably many other forms that we haven't given names to yet. So what are the means by which we do this? Well, traditionally, we use things like nicotine and caffeine and alcohol. These are all legal, they're used widely. Marijuana is now legal in some places and used very widely. These are coca leaves, cocaine is not yet legal, but used widely. These are opium poppies, again, forms the economy of places like Afghanistan now. Mushrooms and meditation. So these have been used for millennia as ways of expanding consciousness. We're all familiar with those. Starting in the 1960s, you had people like Elmer Green who were studying the claims of yogis who said that they can control their autonomic nervous system. Well, the autonomic nervous system was called that because of the word autonomic, meaning it happens without your attention. So it was thought to that point that the yogis claimed that they could slow their heart or they can slow their breathing was nonsense. So in the 1960s, it started to be studied and it was learned that you can, in fact, change your autonomic nervous system by putting your attention there. And so this gave rise to things like biofeedback and eventually neurofeedback. And again, both of these methods are used quite a bit now to alter consciousness. Sound has been used forever as another means of altering consciousness. One of the technologies, of course, is hemisync. and many other techniques that are using sound as binaural beats and similar methods. And of course, one of the most traditional and still used widely methods is chanting. This is one by the Dalai Lama. So that's the Dalai Lama doing one of the traditional Buddhist chants. Then we're coming more into the 1990s and beyond. Here we're talking about electrical and magnetic stimulation, and this is where it becomes particularly interesting. What you're looking at there on the left is Professor Xavier from the X-Men series. He's wearing something called a Cerebro, which takes his natural psychic talent and allows him to actually perceive every human being on the planet with this machine. Here's a clip of Professor X. So that's science fiction, but as often happens, we're actually getting kind of close to that. Here's Michael Persinger from Laurentian University in Canada, who for many years has been proposing that if you take magnetic stimulation methods and use it to influence the brain, that you could evoke things. And so what he's able to evoke using his magnetic methods are out-of-body states, the feeling of presence of somebody who's not there, actually induce forms of remote viewing, things of that sort. And this is one of the original helmets that was built in order to produce magnetic stimulation into the temporal lobe. So one of the ways of thinking about what's going on here is that rather than inducing epilepsy, he's producing a microepilepsy in the temporal lobe, which is the place where, among other things, you have the sense of where yourself is. So if you stimulate that, you no longer necessarily feel like you're yourself anymore. That's where these strange effects come from. We also have Alan Snyder from the University of Sydney in Australia, who has been using, again, magnetic stimulation, this time over the frontal lobes. And he did this because he was interested to see whether autistic savants might be created by taking a normal person who's not an autistic savant, put magnetic stimulation over the frontal lobes to inhibit their activity for about a half an hour to an hour, and see whether or not they could then exhibit some elements of what autistic savants do. So this is an example of somebody who is asked to draw a picture of a dog, and the number one is before the magnetic stimulation, or their practice, and then before stimulation. This is during and after stimulation, the same person. And what it shows is that if you get the frontal lobes out of the way, you get our analytical side of the brain out of the way, we are much, much better at perceiving what is actually there. So what's interesting about this is I have a colleague at the University of Toronto who has been studying patients with brain damage in the frontal lobes. And he had the idea that if it's really true that psychic phenomena are blocked by our analytical side, then if you work with patients who have lesions in their frontal lobes, maybe they're going to be much more psychic. So he did experiments with them, mind-matter interaction experiments with random number generators, and sure enough, he found that one of the patients he studied was able to get significant effects repeatedly in those studies. And of course, that patient was not doing too well because part of his frontal lobe wasn't working, but he was able to do the experiment and was able to do it repeatedly in a way that you normally don't see with a person who doesn't have brain damage. So this is a clue that if you create a system like this, you might be able to induce an additional psychic ability. Mikey Siegel has started something called the consciousness hacking movement. And this is something where you take the best of what we knew from the psychedelic 60s and biofeedback and neurofeedback and all of the modern technologies and create new methods of hacking consciousness. So he has meetups in Santa Cruz and meetups in New York City and now around the world. So this is a worldwide effort now by technically oriented people who are interested in consciousness, and there are many of them. This has led to products that you can buy now. These are all roughly about $300. Little gizmos that you put on your head, which are used or based on something called transcranial DC stimulation. So it puts about 1 milliamp of current across your frontal lobes or across a frontal lobe to the back, and it produces various effects. The one on the bottom right there is showing something that is designed to treat depression and anxiety in young people, in which case it has to look colorful and have an eyeball on it. But it's the same kind of technology as putting current across your brain.
From coffee to yoga, we all have ways of altering our mood to get through the day. Think is working on a module that stimulates your brain with mild electrical pulses to induce calmness or energy.
Would be.
So how much of you telling me this is like going to placebo affect my brain into being calmer?
Yeah, it's a great question. So we spent 18 months doing exactly that, testing people placebo effect against our technique active. And that is the basis of the science. But the placebo effect will be there initially, I'm sure, as well. That's okay. And then as you use it more and more, it will be purely the effect.
Given the fact that you're working with the fight or flight response, which is like a very like, you know, low-level instinctual reaction.
Yeah.
Does that mean calm or excited are like the only ends of the spectrum you can influence, or are there other emotions that you could bring about with the same technique?
For this product, there are the two modes that we have focused on.
Okay.
And that we did that because they're gigantic in terms of impact. I mean, there are so many things that add stress to people's lives. And if you can center yourself and be calm through them, you just have better mornings, better afternoons, better evenings. A big application for calm vibes are before bed. People just want an off button, just chill out, go to bed.
So we're about almost 10 minutes into this demo, and I'm pretty certain I'm feeling it.
So I have a version of this. This is called Think, and there's another one called Focus, and it actually does produce an effect. It feels like a buzz if you're pushing on the energy side, and otherwise it feels very calm on the other side. It's a little tricky when you think about this because you're actually electrically affecting your brain. This is like electroconvulsive shock, except at a very, very low level. So it's considered to be safe. There have been thousands of studies done or thousands of subjects and experiments, and it doesn't have a lasting effect as far as we know. So you'll soon see people walking around with these things on their head. Another topic is nootropics, and there are a number of articles written on this now, like in Wired and New Yorker and places like that. And they're talking about smart drugs, brain enhancers, neuro enhancers. This is the psychedelic 60s, again, brought up to speed. So it's like skip the generation, and here we are with new drugs, most of which are synthetic. So the smart drugs are going commercial. You can go to GNC or any vitamin store and get ginkgo biloba, but you can also buy things like Active Mind, only $20. Or Piracetam, which is a synthetic drug actually found to improve cognitive ability, and many others. This one's called Epiphany D, presumably the decongestant version of Epiphany. And of course, we still have psychedelics, and the nice thing about psychedelics now is that they were pushed way underground for probably 30 to 40 years by being Schedule I in the United States, but now there are more and more medical groups that are beginning to study the use of psilocybin and DMT and so on. DMT is being studied, psilocybin, MDMA, otherwise known as Molly or ecstasy. Ayahuasca ceremonies are very popular now. LSD is still used, salvia divinorum, mescaline, peyote, on and on and on. When you take the entire list of available psychedelics, it's way over 100. About half of them are synthetic. Psilocybin has been synthesized now, and studies that are using psilocybin in medical contexts are using the synthetic chemical and not the mushroom. And there's a lot of science fiction that is based on this idea. Here's one from Dune, talking about spice. So spice is a substance that is taken, and in this case, the story is that without this substance, the universe the civilization that has spread out through the universe would not work anymore. So here's the description.
A beginning is a very delicate time. Know then that it is the year 10,191. The known universe is ruled by the Padishah Emperor Shaddam IV, my father. In this time, the most precious substance in the universe is the spice melange. The spice extends life. The spice expands consciousness. The spice is vital to space travel. The Spacing Guild and its navigators, who the spice has mutated over 4,000 years, use the orange spice gas, which gives them the ability to fold space. That is, travel to any part of the universe without moving.
So I'm going to talk more and more about fiction now, because fiction is a way of projecting from where we are. And if you imagine that the mind-matter interactions that we see in the laboratory are pretty small, but if we find ways of significantly improving them, something like that story could actually take place. We also have now the possibility of doing genetic selection and enhancement. So we know all about identical twins and so on, and there are cases in every culture of people who have these abilities that run in families. So there's studies going way back into the Scottish Highlands where there are people in the same family for many generations who had the sight, the second sight, the ability which we would now call something like clairvoyance. The question is whether this was nature or nurture. And so one of the projects I'm working on now is to see whether or not we can study people who are either identical twins or members of the same family who have psychic ability, use the modern genome techniques to look for a constellation of genes that are associated with these abilities. If we find them, we might be able to both enhance and suppress these abilities. Anybody know how much it costs to run the first human genome? It costs $3 billion. Today it costs $1,000, and it's going down day by day. So you'd be able to, you can already run your entire genome if you wish, and that allows this kind of a study to take place. So there may be genetic engineering that takes place as well. If it turns out that you need to do a couple of snips and snaps and you can make somebody psychic, then we're going to create the X-Men. Before that, we can certainly do talent selection and cultivation. We know that there are child prodigies, child geniuses. There are also child geniuses in this domain, in the psychic domain. They usually learn pretty quickly not to display those talents because it freaks people out. But if we were able to select them and cultivate them, kind of in the way that Professor Xavier did in his school for gifted youngsters, I use euphemism, or perhaps you'd want to see it in terms of Hogwarts, or in the way that Arthur C. Clarke wrote in his book Childhood's End, that at some point, pressure from the environment, pressure from evolution creates children. There's stories about indigo children and so on. But we're talking about children who are genius-level psychic ability. To maintain an ordinary existence in our society, it would be very difficult for such children. They'd have to basically turn it off in order to be able to be normal. But if there were a way to cultivate that gift, then we're talking basically about the children growing up and then leaving the planet as they do in Childhood's End, because they'd be able to do that. Another whole area is the notion of machine consciousness.
For 130,000 years, our capacity for reason has remained unchanged.
Lost the audio.
For 130,000 years, our capacity for reason has remained unchanged. The combined intellect of the neuroscientists, engineers, mathematicians pales in comparison to even the most basic AI. Once online, a sentient machine will quickly overcome the limits of biology. In a short time, its analytical power will be greater than the collective intelligence of every person born in the history of the world. Some scientists refer to this as the singularity. I call it transcendence.
So this is a recurrent theme that you'll see in movies again and again, that we're talking about something dramatic. Maybe there'll be a singularity in artificial intelligence, maybe not. But you notice at the end there, the character, the actor is Johnny Depp, and he doesn't look very happy. And this you see again and again in these stories, because most of the projection of what happens in these cases is not very pleasant. Even though if you've seen the movie Transcendence, you'll see that his intention actually is very positive. So we just don't react to it very well. Here's another example of machine intelligence.
For 2 million years, the human brain has evolved more than any species in existence. But what if all our knowledge, all our accomplishments, and all our achievements could be learned in mere minutes? What if humanity's next evolution wasn't human at all? What happens when artificial intelligence becomes self-aware? Is it the key to immortality, or is it the path towards annihilation?
So we don't know yet whether machines can gain consciousness. If you are a philosopher and accept the idea of panpsychism, then perhaps they could, because we don't know where consciousness begins. Maybe it permeates everything, in which case even a hunk of metal in silicon has proto-consciousness. If you put it into a complex enough condition, maybe it will be conscious. And if it is, as these stories suggest, it will become way smarter than we are very quickly. And then the question is, what does it do with us? Well, this is what Hollywood specializes in. There are lots and lots of stories which look at these kinds of ideas. The vast majority of them are in the horror genre. They're about apocalyptic outcomes. The advantage of all of this is that people who write fiction are very good at projecting where we are. They're also projecting current fears about things, typically. I don't like the fact that science fiction and horror are mixed into the same genre, because they really shouldn't be. But for some reason, this works in Hollywood, and it must be difficult to make stories that have positive outcomes. And the disadvantage is that when I talk to the groups of scientists, that when they hear the kinds of research that I do, what they have in their head is this. They have these kinds of stories, which of course are major embellishments beyond what is reasonable. So I have to pull back from this and say, no, I'm not doing that. But nevertheless, what we're seeing in the laboratory are, in principle, showing that these kinds of things actually exist. As examples, you have stories like The Shining, one called The Sender, Carrie, The Sixth Sense. They all have horror, basically, underneath the story. At least The Sixth Sense was more about mystery than horror. But they're always portrayed in a kind of a creepy way, which I don't particularly like. The other thing is the Frankenstein notion, that in the movie Phenomenon and another movie named Powder, the major characters are very different than others. In the case of Phenomenon, he gained the power through some kind of a lightning bolt or something, and Powder just was born that way. They have exceptional psychic abilities and expanded consciousness, and they cannot live. The story says they must disappear, they must die, they must go away, because they can't live in the society that we live in. And this actually, I think, is pretty accurate. It's something I've heard from exceptional psychics who hide it, because they know you're not supposed to talk about it. So we need to imagine a society where these kinds of things are encouraged and allowed, and that will be a very different kind of world. We have other stories like Minority Report, where this was a Philip K. Dick story, exploring the consequences, in this case for policing, that if something like precognition was used to stop crime before it occurred. Similar kind of story in Next. This is one with Nicolas Cage as a character who is able to perceive the future 3 seconds in advance, which doesn't sound like much, but it's a very interesting movie if you haven't seen it, to see how he lives as somebody who can sample the future 3 seconds ahead and what he does as a result. There are a number of movies that make fun of this notion, like The Men Who Stare at Goats, or Vibes, or Ghostbusters. It's a nice theme to make fun of. And this is a very, very old story. Even when the movies were just beginning in 1935, there's a movie by Claude Rains and Fay Wray called The Clairvoyant. And this is based on a story where you have a mentalist who is faking psychic phenomena and he's doing it in front of audiences and doing shows. And then he notices that when there's a certain woman who gets near him, that he's getting real psychic information. So he starts making predictions which turn out to be true, and of course he gets in trouble over it because people think, how could he possibly know that? He must have made these things happen. And the story ensues. Recent stories looking at the use of pharmaceutical methods of creating exceptional consciousness-related effects. One is Lucy, the other one is Limitless. I've watched both of them 5 times because they're fun to watch. The conceit in Lucy is that we use 10% of our brain. If you take a certain drug, you can use 50, 60, and eventually 100% of your brain. Well, that's not really accurate, and even the person who wrote the story knows that it's not accurate, but it was a way to introduce the notion in the movie. So here's a clip from Lucy where she has to retrieve something that a bad guy has.
Give me the case.
It's going to show in a minute that she has 60% of her brain capacity. You don't want to mess with Lucy. This is a great character because Lucy's kind of a fly-by-night floozy in the beginning, and so she has advanced cognitive capacity as well as these other powers that are developed through the movie. The other one is Limitless. In Limitless, you have the story of a person who's trying to be a writer, and has chronic writer's block and can't get their life together. And then he encounters a pill, which you'll see. So he has writer's block here, doesn't know how to write. Takes the pill. The world becomes colorful, and he's going to sit down in the space of an hour, write a bestseller. So on the internet, you find people saying, what did he take? Where can I buy that? Well, you can buy versions of that, like priacetam is a version of a cognitive enhancement chemical. These things don't work on everybody, but some people take it and they do notice a pretty significant increase in cognitive capacity over a matter of hours. I have some of this I bought, and it comes with a really tiny spoon, the smallest spoon I have ever seen. Because they have a little caution in this that we don't actually know what happens if you take a lot of this. So They give you this tiny, tiny little spoon. Say, just take that much. You know, in this case, more is not necessarily better. So what do we do when we start developing these things? Well, one thing I hope that happens is our ability to do things like energy healing becomes much, much better because we begin to understand it better. So maybe in the realm of health and healing, we can do some significant advancement. Certainly in the realm of exploration. I mean, right now, the search for extraterrestrial intelligence is still looking for signals like radio signals, which doesn't make any sense at all to me because our use of radio is already going away. Like, we don't even have broadcast TV. So a very, very small space in our history has had electromagnetic signals going out. And why are we looking for that elsewhere in the universe? There may be planets or civilizations millions of years ahead of us, which by now have certainly figured out some of these psychic technologies. So we should be using psychics for the search for extraterrestrial intelligence, but so far there's no money for that. The other thing is, of course, that precognition becomes significantly better and the future is not fixed but probabilistic, then we should be able to make much better decisions because we can sample possible decisions before we actually take them. And maybe we'll learn a little bit, like Bertrand Russell said, that the whole problem with the world is that fools and fanatics are always so certain of themselves and wiser people so full of doubts. So maybe we'll learn to be a little more humble about what we're actually capable of, because the moment that we actually do become a little more, a little smarter and have these psychic abilities, we'll realize what is left to learn. And what is left to learn is always much, much bigger than what we know. So now the perils. The perils is it's both a blessing and a curse to feel everything so deeply. So here's an example of such an outcome.
I felt a great disturbance in the force, as if millions of voices suddenly cried out in terror and were suddenly silenced. I fear something terrible has happened.
So if you were Obi-Wan Kenobi and you could not block that, there's always a disturbance in the force. There's always something happening somewhere. In this case, it was big enough because an entire planet was blown up. But this is a problem for people who are too sensitive. And this one, this is not really related to my story directly, but it's so interesting because here's Obi-Wan Kenobi, the person, the actor, Alec Guinness, and he has a story.
You also met Dean, didn't you, James?
Well,
Dean?
My very first night in Hollywood, I met James Dean. It was a very, very odd occurrence. I'd arrived off the plane, but those were, you know, took a long time in those days, about 16 hours flight. And I'd been met by Grace Kelly and various people, but I found that I was alone for myself for the evening. And a woman I knew phoned up and said, let me take you out to dinner. And we went to various places, and she was wearing trousers, and they wouldn't let her in any of the smart Hollywood restaurants. Think of it, you know, whatever it was, 1952, 54, something like that. However, we finally went to a little Italian dive, and that was full. And so one got turned away. I said, honestly, I don't mind just a hamburger anyway. I was hungry by then. And then I heard feet running down the street, and it was James Dean. And he said, I was in that restaurant, you couldn't get a table. And my name's James Dean. He said, will you come and join me? So we said, yes, very kind of him. And then going back into the restaurant, he said, oh, before we go in, I must show you something. I've just got a new car. And there in the courtyard of this little restaurant was I don't know what the car was, some little silver, very smart thing, all done up in cellophane with a bunch of roses tied to its bonnet. And I said, how fast can you drive in this? He said, oh, I can do 150 in it. And I said, have you driven it? He said, no, I've never been in it at all. And some strange thing came over me, some almost different voice. And I said, look, I won't join your table unless you want me to, but I must say something. Please do not get into that car. Because if you do, and I looked at my watch, and I said, if you get into that car at all, it's now Thursday, whatever the date was, 10 o'clock at night, and by 10 o'clock at night next Thursday, you'll be dead if you get into that car. I said, oh, nonsense. It's So we had dinner, we had a charming dinner, and he was dead the following Thursday afternoon in that car. It was one of those odd things.
Where has it ever happened to you before?
No, I'm glad to say. But it was one of a very, very odd, spooky experience. I liked him very much too. I would love to have known him more.
So that's interesting. This is the actor who plays someone who has this kind of experience. One of the perils here is the loss of privacy. There's concern already about everything you do on the internet is watched by somebody somewhere, sometime, and used. If we get really, really good thought police, then everything you think is going to be watched all the time. There's a fear of loss of ego, that the moment you are able to expand beyond yourself, who are you anymore? Who's the person in there? And this becomes like a Russian doll with lots of little U's inside there. Fear of loss of control, that if you are sensing other people's emotions and thoughts and so on, it can be difficult to know who you are. And this, of course, is one of the fears that's often explored in stories. It could drive you crazy. Religions have various ideas about these things. They're considered supernatural in many religions and either considered demonic or saintly, but there's no room for humans here. And this is one of the reasons why in countries that have strong religious movements, it's very difficult to do the kind of research that we do without encountering people who think we're doing the work of the devil or think we're doing the work of saints but shouldn't. So is it this? This is the model that we're working with, or is it that? Well, I'm not a very religious person, so I prefer the one on the bottom, but who knows? I could be wrong. There's also the potential for a huge societal disruption, which is yet another reason why this research is kind of slow. In the movie Forbidden Planet, which is based on Shakespeare's The Tempest, it's the notion that we figure out ways of taking your whims and intentions and manifesting them. And the movie shows and The Tempest shows and lots of other stories show that this will destroy us very quickly, because we don't have very good control over our whims. Likewise, if your mind expands out, then there's going to be something like a collective mind or a hive mind. This is seen as horrific, both in as the Borg, where resistance is futile, and Invasion of the Body Snatchers, and lots of other movies where it's considered that if you lose your individuality, this is the worst possible thing that could ever happen. There are ethics involved in all of this. Should you be arrested for a crime you might commit, or that you probabilistically can commit? Should you be held responsible for your thoughts? Well, from a legal perspective, you're responsible for your actions, but not your thoughts, at least not yet. If we have laws that then control what you think, that could be quite interesting. So where are we headed with all this? As Lucy would say, a different Lucy. Well, I think that what we're going to find is that matter and energy, space and time, we know now our relationships. They collaborate with each other. We'll find that mind and matter are relationships as well. And so here's our future. We have four possibilities that I can think of. The first one is maintain the status quo, just stop asking questions. Don't do this, go away. This is still pretty prevalent in the United States. I'm finding in Southeast Asia and Australia and other places where I'm invited to give talks at very high levels, they're very interested in this. They are asking these questions. No one in the United States at the level that I've spoken to in other countries has invited me to talk about this, except in private, not in public. Another possibility is the secret elite. We knew that our government had a secret program of psychic espionage. We know the Russians had one at the same time. We suspect the Chinese do. We suspect everyone does. One of the people at the meeting in Australia was the head of their Defense Intelligence Agency, and after I spoke about the U.S. program, he said, oh yeah, we were tracking them. We know all about that. They don't have their own program, as far as I know. If they did, he didn't tell me. But governments are very interested in this, but they're keeping it secret. We may be forced by circumstances, by all of the apocalyptic scenarios, to reinvent ourselves, and necessity will make us take this next step and make an advancement. Or there could be something completely out of the blue. One of the problems in trying to anticipate the future, of course, is that unintended consequences are always there. So we don't really know what's going to happen once we develop these technologies. I do think the technologies are in our future because we already can see if you can buy a $300 machine and make your brain do things that it wasn't going to do otherwise and do it quite effectively, then we're not too far from enhancing our psychic ability as well. We're just expanding consciousness in general. And so I've reached the end of my time. I thank you for your attention. Thank you very much.